the military heart of the Nazi war machine. A city of concrete and steel, designed to command millions of soldiers.
Die gesamte Generalität.
To control a vast empire. And direct a world war. A base engineered to hide the leaders of the Third Reich. And built on a scale to match Hitler's lust for power. This is the story of the Third Reich's center of power and Hitler's most secret headquarters, the Wolf's Lair. The biggest construction projects of World War II, ordered by Hitler to secure world domination. Now they survive as dark reminders of the Führer's fanatical military ambition. These are the secrets of the Nazi megastructures. The 20th of July, 1944. Hitler isolates himself in his 2.5 square mile bunker complex, while his German armies are in retreat. As his grip on Europe weakens, he withdraws further into his concrete base. His paranoia grows. And a group of German rebels plot to turn the bunkers of the Wolf's Lair against him. The roots of these headquarters lie in the very first days of the war. On the 1st of September 1939, Hitler's armies race across the Polish border. World War II has begun. This early success convinces Hitler of his own military genius. He begins to ignore the advice of his army generals. Senior German soldiers are traditionally upper-class aristocrats, and many despise the Führer. Hitler is becoming paranoid. He believes the only way to keep control of his generals is to lead from the front. He leaves the safety of Berlin for the war zone in Poland on his specially designed train. Two streamlined locomotives pull a convoy of 15 carriages. Anti-aircraft flak wagons top and tail the train. At its heart is Hitler's private carriage, followed by the command unit for war conferences. Hitler is determined to direct the war personally. Poland is conquered by the 6th of October 1939. It's a stunning victory. Hitler's next target is France, and then Britain. The Allies' sophisticated planes and bombs make his train vulnerable. Hitler still wants to be close to the front lines. So he demands a new kind of HQ. He orders a base near the Belgian border, codenamed Rocky Nest, or Felsennest in German. The Führer is protected by two rings of high security, swarming with checkpoints and soldiers. The inner ring is the heart of the site. Two bunkers with adjacent wooden huts are built for Hitler and his entourage. Hitler arrives at Felsennest on the 10th of May 1940. He orders the attack on Western Europe during the journey. Early in the morning, the German invasion begins.
Wir haben die Feinde gezwungen,
the enemy,
sich
to withdraw from our borders.
The bunker protects the Führer from the war, but at the same time isolates him from his generals. His total belief in his own genius grows. Success follows success as Hitler's military sweeps past his headquarters and across Western Europe. By the 6th of June 1940, the advance has been so rapid that Felsenest is now far behind the front lines. Less than 3 weeks later, France surrenders. Hitler is triumphant. Hitler has now doubled the size of his Nazi empire. His frontline officers are impressed by his military ability. One such officer is 32-year-old Catholic aristocrat and father of five, Klaus von Stauffenberg.
The bombers will smoke them out of the forest. If we strike fast, we can cut this rabble off.
July 1940. Hitler has conquered Western Europe from specialized command centers. His next headquarters will expand the concept on a huge scale. Hitler is convinced massive frontline command centers are vital to his success. Now he looks east, to Russia. Hitler plans for an epic invasion, using 4 million soldiers along an 1,800-mile front. The attack will be codenamed Barbarossa. For the impending attack, Hitler needs a base as far east as possible. He chooses a site near the city of Rastenburg, then in eastern Germany. Felsenest is the template. The swamps make building underground bunkers extremely difficult. In the autumn of 1940, Fritz Todt, the head of Nazi engineering group Organization Todt, personally takes charge of the project. He decides that heavily reinforced structures above ground are the solution. The budget is 36 million Reichsmarks, an incredible $250 million today. Amazingly, the chosen site sits directly beneath the daily route of Russia's Moscow to Berlin airliner. The forest means it's never discovered. Soldiers protect German laborers to maintain security for the top secret project. While construction is underway, Hitler continues to use his train, but he's paranoid about being attacked from the air. One shelter in the occupied Polish town of Stelpina still remains. It's capable of withstanding any assault, as tunnel expert Maciej Pienkosz explains.
The train here in Stepina could hide from any danger, from air raid, shelling or a chemical attack, as the interior of this shelter is closed off.
In the summer of 1940, nearly 6,000 Polish slave laborers begin construction on the 1,300-foot-long tunnel.
Above us, we have 3-meter thick walls made up of reinforced concrete. The inside of this wall is filled with tons of armored steel, which makes them able to withstand strikes and explosions of even a half-ton bomb.
Despite taking a year to complete, the massive tunnel is only used by Hitler once during the entire war, for a meeting with Italian dictator Benito Mussolini. By summer 1941, preparations are complete for Hitler's masterstroke, the invasion of Russia. And the ultimate Führer HQ is ready for occupation. The 22nd of June, 1941. Germany invades Russia. 2 days later, Hitler arrives at his newest headquarters. His military codename is Wolf, so he names it the Wolf's Lair. Russia collapses in the first weeks of the invasion. The front line moves far away from the Wolf's Lair. Hitler feels secure in his new base, and so confident of victory that he chooses not to advance with the troops. It's a critical error. His distance from the front and his generals leaves him disconnected and begins to affect his decisions. In September 1941, he orders his generals to stop their advance on Moscow and attack other Russian cities. The invasion grinds to a halt. Determined to wipe out the Russians, Hitler orders the killing of millions of civilians. Many German soldiers see the order as immoral and dishonorable. 34-year-old Klaus von Stauffenberg, a devout Catholic, is one of them. In May 1942, torn between his loyalty to Germany and his sense of honor, he decides that Hitler's megalomania is the greater evil. Resignation would mean death, so he chooses to plot in secret against the Führer. By the summer, Hitler's armies begin to retreat, chased by huge numbers of Russian forces. Hitler's paranoia increases, and he isolates himself further by fortifying the Wolf's Lair. 1,500 troops now patrol the area, and dozens of additional buildings are added across the site. Hitler is the head of the Nazi Empire. None of his generals dare to question him. All operations revolve around him, but his behavior is increasingly eccentric. Hitler wakes late at 10 a.m. Conferences take place when he chooses, regardless of the military situation. In Stalingrad, German forces fight bloody battles in the city. At the Wolf's Lair, Hitler demands staff attend daily afternoon parties at a specially built tea room. Three 300,000 troops are going hungry in Stalingrad. But Hitler dismisses reports that interrupt his schedule, no matter the consequences. February 1943. Germany is defeated at Stalingrad. In July, Hitler hastily orders a counterattack from his bunker in the Wolf's Lair. It's crushed, and Germany is under threat like never before. For the first time, the Wolf is vulnerable in his lair. Hitler's isolation in his bunker complex has led to a series of terrible military decisions. Germany is under assault. The Führer's paranoia is stoked by fear of air attacks. He orders a new mammoth bunker built for himself. Construction begins on a massive structure, 200 feet long and 120 feet wide. 23 feet of concrete divided by a layer of sand will surround the Führer on all sides. Inside, Hitler's living space will be a tiny 9 by 11 feet. His staff are astonished by the scale of the building work.
It's incredible what they achieved in such a short time.
Although its exact layout has never been fully verified, the bunker contains a warren of corridors and small rooms. This final stage of the Wolf's Lair uses material desperately needed elsewhere for the war effort, including enough concrete to build the Empire State Building 3.5 times over. The massive fortifications only help Hitler's complete withdrawal from reality. That isolation from the war has led Hitler to make appalling military decisions. Von Stauffenberg has experienced the results personally, losing a hand and an eye in battle. He and a network of sympathizers are plotting Hitler's downfall.
It's a choice between two evils, action or inaction.
The war is being lost, and von Stauffenberg is convinced that Germany can only be saved if Hitler is killed.
I sincerely believe God has assigned me this mission. I will devote myself to it entirely.
The 6th of June, 1944, D-Day. The Americans and British land in France. It's a decisive blow to Germany. Defeat is imminent. Von Stauffenberg must find a way to kill Hitler before Germany is crushed. Despite its immense security, von Stauffenberg decides that the Wolf's Lair is the only viable target. He plans to turn the isolated headquarters against the Führer. Von Stauffenberg is promoted to a post that gives him permission to attend Hitler's conferences at the Wolf's Lair. The plan hinges on using the Wolf's Lair's massive engineering against the Führer. If von Stauffenberg can detonate the bomb inside a concrete bunker, the explosion will kill everyone inside. On the 20th of July, 1944, von Stauffenberg is ordered to a briefing at the Wolf's Lair. This is his chance. The bomb's 30-minute fuse has been armed.
Please?
Not the Führer bunker?
It's too hot. Please.
He's told that the meeting has been moved from a concrete bunker to a lightweight brick hut. The well-ventilated and thin-walled building could limit the bomb's destructive power, but it's too late to turn back now. He must improvise and find a way to get the bomb as close to Hitler as possible.
Would you please place me close to the Führer? I have trouble hearing due to my injuries.
Yes, come in.
Another officer unknowingly carries the bomb inside.
The second army, that's no use. The objective now is to keep the Soviet troops occupied so long to finish.
The bomb is placed just 6 feet from Hitler.
General Mannerheim, I have told General Mannerheim that the interests of the German people and the Finnish people are identical.
Here is Colonel von Stauffenberg, mein Führer.
Mein Führer?
So, the Russian positions are here and here. We need to prevent the Romanian oil fields from falling into Russian hands.
Von Stauffenberg claims he has to make a telephone call and leaves the room. It has been almost 30 minutes since he armed the bomb.
That's the truth now. As it currently stands, we cannot prevent it.
Where's Stauffenberg? It's his turn.
Von Stauffenberg has brought the war to the wolf's lair and to the wolf himself. In the aftermath of the explosion, panicked Nazis race to locate Hitler. Von Stauffenberg bluffs his way past security. He's convinced he has succeeded in killing Hitler and heads to Berlin to seize control. Four officers are dead, but Hitler is alive. Footage filmed just after the explosion reveals the damage.
By the time this von Stauffenberg arrives in Berlin, he knows that the bomb has gone off, but it becomes increasingly apparent that Hitler hasn't actually died.
Hitler's injuries are minor, but his narrow escape has left him enraged.
For all its concrete and layers of security, the Wolf's Lair proved to be defenseless against one man with a bomb in a briefcase.
Nazi investigators quickly realized that von Stauffenberg left the meeting early.
Those who are loyal to Hitler start to realize what is going on. The coup is undone very quickly.
Hitler's troops track the ringleaders to Berlin's army headquarters.
Von Stauffenberg and his fellow plotters are dragged out into the courtyard from where they are operating the plot and summarily executed on the spot.
In the following weeks, 600 suspected conspirators are arrested and publicly tried by Nazi judges. Around 200 are eventually executed. At the Wolf's Lair, Hitler watches the films of their deaths for his own pleasure, but he ignores the catastrophic situation in the war. By the end of August, the Russians are less than 60 miles from the base.
It's all very well having impregnable, bomb-proof forward headquarters, but if the area in which it sits is overrun, then it's no good to anybody.
The greatest flaw of the Wolf's Lair is that it's only safe if Germany's armies are victorious.
If the Luftwaffe manages to even find this is a damn disgrace!
On the 8th of November, construction finishes on Hitler's enormous personal bunker. But he spends only 12 days inside it. With the Russians entering Germany, the war is closing in around him.
In November 1944, Hitler left the Wolf's Lair for the last time along this railway. In total, he'd spent over 800 days in residence, longer than at any other place during the war. The Russians were hot on his heels, but they simply circumvented the place on their way to Berlin. And it wasn't until January of 1945 that the Germans got round to trying to demolish it. Local people describe huge chunks of concrete flying through the air as the charges were blown. The Wolf's Lair was history.
The Wolf's Lair was meant to be Hitler's impregnable fortress, and the command center from which he'd conquer the world. But ultimately, no base, however big, could protect Hitler from his own flaws, paranoia, and military incompetence.